To understand the viewpoint of the Nazis and the Serbs, you must first look at the origin of the Serbian identity that was present when the Nazis came to power and reigned, which was Yugoslavia, and the Serbs were dominant in it. King Alexander, which was assassinated by a Macedonian Bulgarian, had been paid respects to by Hitler, with a personal wreath of honor and a German delegation, including Reich Marshal Goering, attending the funeral, even though Alexander was repressive of the Banatian Volksdeutsche. Now, after the death of Alexander and the dictatorship of Prince Regent Paul was announced, the wait for the crowning of Pierre II began, which set off the fuse of a new identity. The Prime Minister of Yugoslavia, Bogoljub Jevtić, whom was plenipotentiary Minister of Yugoslavia in Albania, Austria, and Hungary, and after the aforementioned assassination of King Alexander on the 22nd of December 1934, appointed Prime Minister of Yugoslavia, holding this position until the 24th of June 1935, and he reigned an unstable rule. Only years prior, after Berlin had failed to break into southeastern Europe by way of Austria, it tried to make headway in Belgrade. It promised Austrian Carinthia to Yugoslavia, while Alfred Rosenberg was organizing and financing the central terror organization in Croatia, with the help of the Croatian Surya and other temporal politicians, including Ante Pavelić, the leader of the Croatian Ustaše. Several possibilities existed, including the disintegration of Yugoslavia. If Yugoslavia had cut loose from its allies, breaking away from the Little Entente, and approved the Austro-German Anschluss, it could have received a special zone of influence in Carinthia. However, neither King Alexander nor Jevtić could be brought to that point of view, while insecurity lingered with Hitler in Germany and Mussolini in Italy. However, with Alexander gone and Jevtić with a leg down and being replaced by the new prime minister, the geopolitical shift took place. Jevtić, soon after, joined Sredinović's Yugoslav Radical Union, and Sredinović became prime minister, reigning for 4 years as a masterful statesman and economist, as well as a heavy sympathizer of the Germans and Italians, modeling the Yugoslav Radical Union as a fascist movement in itself. After Alexander's death, we can see a steep decline in the fervent anti-German sentiment of the Yugoslav cabinet, whom was increasingly becoming more pro-German. What is notable in that is how in only a matter of a few years, Yugoslavia went from a nation that was actively undermining German interests to actively going in their favor. After the Austrian government exiled August Mezle, future high SS police leader in Serbia, he was given asylum by Stojadinović's cabinet, and therefore Stojadinović truly cemented that he indeed preferred Germany to many others and the Nazi system before all. Hence, Yugoslavia, which was an anti-German creation, became an instrument of its support. The breaking point of Axis and Yugoslav relations comes shortly before Operation Barbarossa, but to explain that, we must first look at the means to it. Milan Stojadinović, a man who saved Yugoslavia in the most dire of its times, was endeared by fascists, germanophilic Serbs, Yugoslavs, and Nazis abroad. Stojadinović single-handedly built the pillars of a new table of diplomacy with the new ideologues of Europe to a successful degree. It was difficult to say if he left a better impression on the Italians or on the Germans. Sciano reciprocated Stojadinović's admiration of fascist Italy, writing in his diary, "He is, quote, our sincere friend, a strong, full-blooded man with a resonant laugh and a strong handshake, a man who inspires confidence. Of all the political men I have encountered so far in my European wanderings, he is the one I find the most interesting." End of quote. And on the other side, taking into context that under the Little Entente of 1921, Yugoslavia was obligated to go to war if Hungary attacked either Czechoslovakia or Romania. In January 1938, Stojadinović visited Germany to meet Hitler and assured him that he was a personal admirer of the Führer, who wanted much closer German-Yugoslav ties. Hitler, for his part, assured Stojadinović that as long as he continued his pro-German policies, that not only would Germany never attack Yugoslavia, but would also not support Hungary's claims against Yugoslavia, which for Sredinovic validated his foreign policy. Sredinovic promised Hitler that Yugoslavia would accept any Anschluss with Austria, as Yugoslavia regarded the question of annexing Austria as a, quote, internal, end of quote, German matter. Sredinovic stated that Yugoslavia had always enjoyed good relations with Germany, except when it viewed the Reich through, quote, somebody else's spectacles, which was a reference to France, leading Hitler to say that Germany no longer viewed Yugoslavia through Viennese spectacles. After the Munich Agreement, Sredinovic appeared quite comfortable with the idea of Germany as the hegemonic power in Eastern Europe, and German-Yugoslav relations had improved so much that in late 1938, Sredinovic began talks about buying weapons from Germany for Yugoslavia. However, at the peak, it all had to crumble. A day before the elections on the 11th of December 1938, Sredinovic told a group of journalists at a press conference in Belgrade that the Yugoslav Radical Union's platform was one king, one nation, one state, prosperity at home, peace on the borders. During the election, Sredinovic presented himself as a strongman, with campaign pamphlets proclaiming the slogan one king, one nation, one state, and featured photographs of Sredinovic giving speeches to his uniformed followers. In late 1938, he was re-elected, though with a smaller margin than expected. He failed in pacifying the Croats, raised a military-like legion of his own followers, called the Green Shirts, and did not formulate any clear political program, providing the Prince Regent Paul with a welcomed pretext upon which to replace Sredinovic, which is exactly what he did on the 5th of February 1939 with Dragiša Cvetković. Prince Paul had by early 1939 come to see the ambitious Sredinovic with his dreams of being a fascist leader as a threat to his own power. Following his replacement, the Prince Regent went further by detaining Sredinovic without proper cause until he had managed, with the help of his strong personal ties to King George VI of the UK, who had been the Prince Regent's best man in 1923, to enlist the support of the United Kingdom to have Sredinovic sent into exile to the British Crown colony of Mauritius, where he was kept during World War II. On the 17th of March 1941, Sredinovic was handed over to a British army force in Greece, from where he was sent to Mauritius. By this point, Paul favored exile as he feared Sredinovic could be the focus of a pro-Axis coup directed from Berlin. Paul wanted to ensure that there was no alternative leadership in Belgrade for which the Axis powers could do a deal with. The British Prime Minister Winston Churchill justified interning Sredinovic in Mauritius as he was a potential quisling and an enemy. With Prime Minister Dragiša Cvetković at the helm, in the future considered puppet leader of occupied Serbia, however sacked due to apparent gypsy heritage, he signed the most important paper in Yugoslavian history, as it would define it therefrom. Cvetković developed the federalization of Yugoslavia to the creation of the Banovina of Croatia via the Cvetković-Maček Agreement, and on the 25th of March 1941, after months of grueling negotiations with the Germans, which gave the Yugoslav government a simply undeniably excellent agreement with Hitler attempting to persuade the Prince Regent himself to immense success, some of his proposals included the suppression of Croatian dissident, that Prince Paul could take the Russian throne after the fall of the Soviet Union, after his regency would end, and that Yugoslavia wouldn't have any real obligation to the Axis other than allowing troop movements through the country, and in reality massively benefiting from it. Adolf Hitler and Ribbentrop exhibited their most goodwill and the treaty was signed. 2 days later, tragedy struck. A British-sponsored coup planned and conducted by a group of pro-Western Serbian nationalist Royal Yugoslav Army Air Force officers, formerly led by its commander, General Dušan Simović, overthrew the regency of Paul and Peter II assumed full power. Hitler, enraged by this development, instantly called for war, marking the entire ordeal as a disgrace to honor, and by the Directive 25, the April War began. Bombs fell all over Yugoslavia, and in 11 days it was all over. Colonel General von Kleist had a parade in Belgrade, and soon after the Croatians found themselves a new state, partitioned by Italy and Germany, and the Serbs directly under German rule. Before the talk about the occupation, I feel obligated to mention the heroic tale of Fritzi Klingenberg, who with six other SS men and a drunk German tourist crossed the Danube and single-handedly took Belgrade. Klingenberg disobeyed orders and decided to reconnoiter Belgrade, with his units far ahead of the main German army. Finding a boat, he made his way across the river with the intention of ferrying a sizable force across. However, the boat sank and he was left with just six men. Klingenberg then encountered some Yugoslav troops who had captured a drunk German tourist, whom they in turn captured. After a number of firefights, the six Germans, having sustained no casualties but capturing a number of Yugoslav soldiers, made it to the center of Belgrade, with the tourists and their prisoners. There, they raised a German flag. The mayor came out to meet them. After Klingenberg bluffed, telling him there was an incoming artillery barrage and an impending Luftwaffe attack, the mayor and some garrison troops surrendered the city to them on the 13th of April. At this point, a few more of Klingenberg's men arrived the same way he had and made a show of their presence, pretending that there was more of them than there actually were. The German army eventually arrived, dumbfounded at the situation, having made a complex plan to take the city that was no longer needed and was expected to cost thousands of lives. A few days later, Yugoslavia surrendered. Klingenberg was awarded the Knight's Cross for capturing the city, in effect capturing Belgrade with just six men. Klingenberg's actions were simply an act of military judgment, audacious courage, and sheer luck and goodwill that saved lives on both sides and showing a story seen nowhere else again.
Chains on a man not 3 feet long.
After the fall of Yugoslavia and its subsequent carve-up by the various Axis powers that participated in the invasion, which occupied and decided on the borders of the newly conquered region, many new conflicts and problems arose. However, I will specifically be covering the occupation of Serbia and its political and military climate. On the note of Serbian administration, Himmler noted, "In Serbia, there should only be the State Guard, which will be supplied with foreign weapons and machine guns that cannot use either German or former Yugoslav ammunition, so it can be strictly rationed by us. All other formations, such as the Chetniks, should be disarmed gradually and in a planned fashion." Never forget that Serbs remain Serbs, and that the Serbian people are a people which have been in armed resistance for centuries and are trained for it. End of quote. Himmler would, of course, as the occupation developed, backtrack on all of these, supplying the Chetniks, State Guard, and newly risen Volunteer Corps with German and Yugoslav weapons, as well as assisting and receiving assistance from Chetniks and other formations in kind to their pragmatic goodwill. Though for now I'll go in the origins of the collaboration government, starting with Germanophilic Serbian former Yugoslav politician Milan Acimovic. Former deputy to Reinhard Heydrich and a close associate of Heinrich Gestapo Müller, head of the Geheime Stadtpolizei, who formed a short-lived commissioner government that lasted from the 1st of May to the 29th of August. The commissioner government, formed of the 10 commissioners, 4 had previously been ministers in various Yugoslav governments, and 2 had been assistant ministers. The members were pro-German, anti-Semitic, and anti-communist, and believed that Germany would win the war. It effectively lacked any real power simply because it refused to go against German interests because they perfectly aligned. Hence why the commissioner government was an extension of the German administration under the overall control of the German military commander in Serbia. Supervision of its day-to-day operations was the responsibility of the chief of the German administrative staff, SS Brigadeführer and State Councillor Harald Turner. One of its early tasks was the implementation of German orders regarding the registration of Jews and Gypsies living in the territory, and the placing of severe restrictions on their liberty. In early July, a few days after a communist-led mass uprising commenced, Acimovic reshuffled his government, replacing 3 commissioners and appointing deputies for most of the portfolios. By mid-July, the Germans had decided that the Acimovic regime was incompetent and unable to deal with the uprising and began looking for a replacement. This resulted in the resignation of the commissioner government at the end of August and the appointment of the Government of National Salvation, led by former Minister of the Army and Navy, Armijski General Milan Nedić, in which Acimovic initially retained the Minister of Interior portfolio. It took severe convincing for Nedić to finally form the government, including a personal visit from Reichsmarschall Göring, which finally gave him resolve. the son, daughter-in-law, and grandson of Milan Nedic died in a munitions explosion whom Nedic thought to be an accident, but was actually conducted by a Bosnian Soviet agent, Mustafa Golubic, who was captured by the Gestapo shortly after in Pančevo, after Heinrich Dankelmann, military commander in Serbia at the time, told him that the real reason for the sabotage being cited as an accident was because if it was cited as sabotage, the Germans would need to execute at least 20,000 Serbs, according to the 100-for-1 law, but they simply loopholed that the Germans falsely cited the reason of the explosion. This, with many other factors, convinced Nedic to form the Government of National Salvation. With the formation of the new government, new military organizations sprung up, notably the Serbian Volunteer Corps and the Commissioner Government's Gendarmerie, which was reorganized into the Serbian State Guard, whose authority was taken over by SS Kopentua August Mezlaja in January of 1942, just 3 days after the Guard's formation, a move Nedic strongly opposed due to Mezlaja's known suspiciousness of the Serbian people and collaborators. Mezlaja was also one of the only men that the Serbians received the Roman salute from. Mezlaja was correct in judging the royalist elements that seeped through the operational system of the National Salvation Government, though the government remained loyal to the Germans, only supplying Chetniks with weapons and money to combat partisans, which was sometimes done by German authority and sometimes secretly. During one of the many talks, the Germans and the Ravnogorci movement, or the USSR army in the homeland, which was formerly called Chetniks, under Draža Mihailović, they were conducted, the Germans openly stated that they know how Draža's loyalty was truly running on fumes, and that, quote, first opportunity he gets, he'll backstab them. These concerns were well known by everyone, with the Chetniks conducting attacks against other Chetnik forces like those of Uroš Drenović or Kosta Pečanacu for their open and constant collaboration, and ambushes of the State Guard, Volunteer Corps, and Germans themselves made for a very strong anti-Chetnik case. However, German tolerance of the Chetniks was rather unusually ignorant, even allowing many members of the National Salvation Government to meet with Mihailović and support them. The German arm was ran immensely by pragmatists, something Mezlaja hated. Most notable of those pragmatics, who also had a genuine liking of the Serbian people, was the already mentioned SS Brigadefuhrer Harold Turner, who was very open and consistent in supporting every element of Serbian collaboration, seeking to model Serbia in the exact same civil administration that Norway was running at the time, with him being supreme German administrator, much like Terboven and Quisling were in Norway. Mezlaja had first-hand experience in Norway as he worked there from 1941 to 1942, though in mid-January 1942 he was recalled to Germany, and despite his low rank, attended the conference of senior SS leaders at Hegewald, Himmler's field headquarters near Wolf's Lair in East Prussia. The conference discussed the use of forced labor, the coming final solution, Generalplan Ost, a supposed plan for the colonization of Central and Eastern Europe by ethnic Germans. Mezlaja's attendance at this conference highlighted his suitability for working in the German-occupied territory of Serbia due to his relevant language skills, hence he was appointed there. Mezlaja's greatest rival, Harold Turner, was also of rather large influence, working in the Rasse- und Siedlungshauptamt der SS, SS Race and Settlement Paying Office, who was by all accounts supposed to be a man dedicated to National Socialism in its purest exhibit. And indeed, one could argue that if a fervent follower of the National Socialist system, such as Turner, loving the Serbian nation and its people could to a degree show how some Germans in practice of the National Socialist ideology saw Serbia. Obviously a speculation, but a reasonable one. Now, with the context of the main players of the German administration explained, it's important to look at the actions and tactics undergone in the occupation by occupational authorities. To understand the partisan war in Yugoslavia, one must firstly look at the formation of the Ušice Republic, the first quote-unquote liberated territory in Serbia, which was organized as a military mini-state that existed in the autumn of 1941 and was swiftly crushed by the Germans and Serbs, as well as provocating a new war between the Chetniks and partisans that established Chetnik identity further from, as not a force that combated Germans, but an effectively anti-partisan German tool. The partisans, completely overwhelmed and suffering more than 50% casualty rate, desperately retreated into Bosnia, making the partisans from that point on a Croatian problem and no longer a Serbian one. And after the partisan operations almost entirely ceased in Serbia, the rebuilding of Serbia commenced. And now to comment on the biggest crimes the Germans committed in Serbia. The first one being the Kraljevo massacre, where the German 717th Wehrmacht Infantry Division killed 2,000 civilians, which came in reprisal for a joint partisan Chetnik attack on a German garrison during the siege of Kraljevo, in which 10 German soldiers were killed and 14 wounded. The civilians were also described in contemporary documents as communists, nationalists, democrats, and Jews. Nedić's inability to crush the partisans and Chetniks prompted the military commander in Serbia to request German reinforcements from other parts of the continent. In mid-September, they transferred the 125th Infantry Regiment from Greece and the 342nd Infantry Division from France to help put down the uprising in Serbia. On the 16th of September, Hitler issued directive number 312 to Generalfeldmarschall Wilhelm List, the Wehrmacht commander in Southeast Europe, ordering him to suppress all resistance in that part of the continent. That same day, the Supreme Commander of the Armed Forces issued Hitler's orders on the suppression of communist armed resistance movements in the occupied areas, signed by Generalfeldmarschall Wilhelm Keitel. This decree specified that all attacks against the Germans on the Eastern Front were to be regarded as being of communist origin, and that 100 hostages were to be shot for every German soldier killed, and 50 were to be shot for every German soldier wounded. It was intended to apply to all of Eastern Europe, though an identical policy had already been implemented in Serbia as early as the 28th of April 1941, aimed at deterring guerrilla attacks. Attacks against the Germans increased in the first half of the year, and Serbia once again became a war zone. German troops fanned through the countryside, burning villages, taking hostages, and establishing concentration camps. The massacre at Kraljevo, as well as a similar and nearly concurrent massacre in nearby Kragujevac, was met with outrage by the Serbian government, which responded with pleas, interventions, threats of resignation, etc. The killings led German military commanders in Serbia to question the efficiency of mass reprisal shootings as they pushed thousands of Serbs into the hands of anti-German guerrillas. The killing of airplane factory workers in Kraljevo convinced the OKW that arbitrary shootings of Serbs not only incurred a significant political cost, but were also counterproductive and useless. The ratio of 100 executions for one soldier killed and 50 executions for one soldier wounded was reduced by half in February 1943 and removed altogether that autumn. Henceforth, each individual execution had to be approved by Special Envoy Hermann Neubacher. The massacre had a profound effect on the course of the war in Yugoslavia. The massacre also exacerbated tensions between the two guerrilla movements, the communist-led partisans and the royalist Serbian nationalist Chetniks, and convinced Chetnik leader Draža Mihailović that further attacks against the Germans would only result in more Serb civilian deaths, hence why from Kraljevo onwards the Chetniks of all formations almost never attacked Germans. Therefore, the end of the Užice Republic marked the end of partisan activity in Serbia until 1944, and Kraljevo-Kragujevac massacres marked the end of atrocities against the Serbian population from then on. The troubles of the early occupation in general marked the end of the troubles of occupation altogether, minus the regular problems all regions faced. However, with Belgrade being declared Judenfrei, or free of Jews, by Heydrich's protege, SS Oberführer Emanuel Schaffer, or Schaffer, head of the Nazi security police in Serbia, and soon after Estonia, Serbia became Judenfrei as a whole nation.
Serbien? Das Auswärtige würde die Bereinigung der serbischen Restjudenfrage begrüßen. Hier sollte man vielleicht ansetzen. Serbien wäre dann das erste Land, das wir dem Führer als Judenfrei melden könnten.
Das zweite? Obergruppenführer, ich melde Estland.
Judenfrei, schon bekannt.
Was Sie haben schon?
Wir sind im Bilde, Gauleiter.
Na schön.
Ich werde wohl melden dürfen, was wir gemacht haben.
Das ist immerhin unser Territorium.
Aber unsere Chose.
Moment, meine Herren. Serbien, Judenrein, das wäre interessant.
Die Arisierungen sind bereits durchgeführt.
Konzentration ist erfolgt.
Kleine Quote.
Mhm. 20.000.
The occupation became rather peaceful and mundane, with the usual exports to the Reich, and rebuilding of Serbia continued in full effect for around 2 years. And while I would love to talk about the most minor of details and events that happened during those years of peace, such as the burial of Serbian soldiers performed by SS Honor Guard in Belgrade, or the various events around the country with occupation authorities, such as traditional celebrations, wintertime celebration, opening of the University of Belgrade,
die in feierlicher Form vollzogene Wiedereröffnung der Belgrader Universität stellt eine wichtige Etappe auf dem Wege der Zusammenarbeit Deutschlands mit dem serbischen Volke dar.
Serbian peasants in Germany.
Bauern in längerer Audienz. In Apollon fanden sich Vertreter der landwirtschaftlichen Kammern und Genossenschaften.
The Grand Anti-Masonic Exhibition, etc., etc., is very interesting, but this video is already long enough as is, and I would prefer to keep it consistent with an in-depth but not too overbearing theme. However, I'll probably make separate videos on some of those occasions when I have the time to do so. After the Soviet breakthrough in Romania and the communist coup in Bulgaria, Serbia and eventually Belgrade were taken by partisan Soviet forces in the offensives up until the final Belgrade one, which was finished on the 28th of October 1944, and then a slow push to Croatia and to Slovenia by the final months of the war. Nedić and what remained of his government fled the country in the first week of October 1944 to Austria, dissolving the regime. In the same month, as the Red Army closed onto Belgrade, the State Guard was transferred to Mihailović's control by General Damjanović, who was a member of the fleeing Nedić administration, and as well as the Četnik, and at which point it fled north and fought under German command in Slovenia. The Serbian Volunteer Corps story during the retreat was most interesting. In mid-September 1944, a corps unit saved Draža Mihailović and the Četnik Supreme Command in northwest Serbia from capture by the partisans. However, the major battle was on the 9th of September, when the partisans totally defeated joint SDK and Četnik forces. The SDK was in early October given a task to defend the Šabac bridgehead and Sava River against the partisans, together with some German units and under the command of Colonel Jungenfeld, the commander of the 5th Police Regiment. On the 14th of October, the battle for Belgrade started, and Germans decided to evacuate the volunteers to some place where it can be used in guarding duties and anti-partisan operations, since the SDK was considered unsuitable for full frontal combat. Hitler ordered to move the SDK to operational zone of the Adriatic littoral, to put it under higher SS and police leader of OZAK, under Commander-in-Chief Southwest. Army Group F commander ordered the boarding of the volunteers for the evacuation on the 17th of October on railway station Ruma, as the clearance from High Command of the Southwest was received for transport on the 19th to 21st of October. On its new position, the volunteers participated in anti-partisan operations. The withdrawal began on the 8th of October during the final joint partisan and Soviet assault on Belgrade, when the 1st Volunteer Regiment under Major Ilya Michašević and the 4th Volunteer Regiment under Major Vojislav Dimitrijević crossed the Sava River. The 3rd Regiment under Major Jovan Dobrosavljević delayed crossing the Sava as they were fighting the partisans in Šabac and met up with the others later in Ruma. The 2nd Regiment under Major Marisav Petrović crossed the Sava near Obrenovac. The 2nd and 3rd battalions of the 5th Regiment were still on the ground. When they reached Niš, they learned that the Red Army had taken Aleksinac and their way to Belgrade was blocked. The commander of the 5th Regiment was forced to change a withdrawal plan and move across the Raška Mountains with the Wehrmacht towards Bosnia. The 1st Battalion of the 5th Regiment under Captain Vasa Ogrizović held Zaječar, but as soon as the Russians crossed the Danube, they moved to Belgrade and crossed the Sava, and they became a temporary part of the 4th Regiment. Most troops met each other at Sremska Mitrovica, where they awaited trains for transfer to Slovenia. Meanwhile, major changes in Berlin affected many non-German volunteers fighting with German forces. There was a branch of service redistribution by ethnic group, and the Serbian volunteers now found themselves under the authority of the Waffen-SS. The order affecting the transfer was dated 9th of November, but not formally recognized until the 27th of November. At this time, the SDK composition on paper was a core staff, 5 regiments, each with 3 battalions, a single company and mountain supply detachment, and a German liaison staff. It is important to point out that at this time, the SDK's relationship with the Waffen-SS was official. The troops never wore SS uniforms, as the uniforms and equipment never reached them in time. And it is doubtful whether the relationship ever went beyond the simple exchange of a limited amount of paperwork. The SDK's situation was quite similar to that of the 15th Kozakin Kavalry Corps, which was also absorbed into the Waffen-SS at about the same time. As they reached Slovenia, the SDK troops, now the SFK as the Zabiše Freiwilligen Corps, concentrated in the area around Ilirska Bistrica and Postojna, with command being set up in Ilirska Bistrica. As soon as he arrived in Slovenia, Dimitrije Ljotić, former leader of the Yugoslav National Movement, current political leader of the SDK, or SFK, and a strong collaboration has got in touch with pro-Nazi Slovenian Domobranci commander Leon Rupnik and Bishop of Ljubljana Georgi Rožman, and agreed on mutual help and cooperation. The SFK established volunteer schools in Ilirska Bistrica, one for officer training and one ideological. The school for officers was directed by Ljotić himself during the settling in period. The 3,000 able-bodied survivors of the SFK were augmented by released Serbian POWs, Chetniks, and members of the Serbian State Guard who had been evacuated to Istria. These additions brought the unit's strength to approximately 10,000. Like the Chetnik Corps and Slovenian Chetniks called Plava Garda, or the Blue Guard, were also present in Slovenia, and they also joined the Nationalist Front. Nationalist formations in Slovenia numbered about 40,000 armed men in total. The part of the 5th Regiment that withdrew reached Bosnia in mid-November and began to move towards Slovenia. It was during the move north that an event befell the SDK, which was to cripple the unit's leadership capability in the coming months. 30 to 40 officers were seized in Zagreb by the Croatian Ustaše and executed. The Ustaše considered them dangerous enemies of the independent state of Croatia, and this was the Ustaše response to the German failure to obtain permission prior to transporting these Serbs through their country. Any Serb who supported the Greater Serbia concept, and as did Ljotić and his followers, was by definition an enemy of Pavelić's Croatia. Though it's important to note how the Ustaše and Pavelić personally saved the life of Momčilo Đujić, a Chetnik leader, when Pavelić personally decided to redirect Ustaše troops to help break out Đujić from a partisan encirclement, and by that saving him. SDK's first major action in Slovenia was to take the partisan-held Kras village of Kol on the 18th of December 1944. From the 19th of December to the end of the month, a major encircle and destroy operation was mounted from the garrison towns of Gorizia, Idrija, Postojna, and Sežana, aiming to eliminate the partisan stronghold in the Trnovska mountains. Nearly 5,000 men were used, including 500 men from the SDK's 1st Regiment in Postojna and the 10th SS Police Regiment, Italian RSI troops, and Slovenian Domobranci. The next campaign participated in by the SDK was against Tito's 9th Corps during the first few days of March 1945, codename Ruzebezal. Two combat groups were formed to strike against partisan concentrations near Lokve. The first group was called Tushnaid and comprised three SS police battalions, elements of the 1st Slovenian Domobranci Assault Regiment, two SDK battalions, and one Caucasian battalion, with a total force of around 5,000 men. The second group, Kuesteman, consisted of two battalions of the German 738th Infantry Regiment, 710th Infantry Division, a police company, and some engineers, with a total of 2,500 men. The attacking forces pushed toward from a south and west direction, and this time the operation was more successful. The partisans suffered moderate losses, and the concentration was broken up and dispersed to the northeast. However, the partisans quickly regrouped, so the Germans were forced to conduct a supplementary operation, which proved to be the final operation against the Tito's 9th Corps. Four combat troops were organized along the perimeter of the area now occupied by the partisans, with the task of bringing the 9th Corps to battle by gradually advancing in unison towards the center, and thereby reducing the size of the area under their control. This was standard German method of cleansing a partisan-controlled area that never significantly changed during the course of the war. To the west, along a line Idrija-Rijeka-Grahovo-Podbro, combat group Blank was assembled with major elements of the 10th and 15th SS Police Regiments. Two SDK regiments, 21st SS Police Reconnaissance, SS Police Company Schmidt, and their artillery battery from the 97th Army Corps. This force was later joined on the 4th of April by the 2nd and 3rd SDK regiments, and 1,500 men from the Chetnik 502 Lika Corps. The second group, under Police Major Dr. Dippelhofer, consisted of the Ljubljana SS NCO School, Slovenian Domobranci, Chetniks, and a 1,200-man Russian ROA unit. This group was deployed to the southeast along the line Idrija-Škofija-Loka. The Northern Assault Group, 4,500 men from the 13th, 17th, and 28th SS Police Regiments, formed up along a road between Podbro and Škofija Loka, while a special assault force from the 14th SS Division was concentrated along the northeastern side of the perimeter. The area encircled was mountainous, thickly forested, and still deep in winter snow. Once off the few roads that encircled the area, the attacking forces were faced with extremely difficult terrain that limited their progress to a few kilometers each day, inhibited contact with neighboring units, and greatly restricted the ability to rapidly bring up fresh supplies and heavy weapons. Very soon, gaps developed in the line of advance, through which the main body of the IX Corps escaped. Although a number of minor skirmishes were fought and casualties suffered on both sides, the overall result of the operation was disappointing. On the 27th of March, General Damjanović replaced General Mušicki as commander of the Serbian Volunteer Corps, and the Estaka became a component of Draža Mihailović's Yugoslav Army of the Homeland, the formal name for the Četnik forces. Although the corps was still assigned to the SS under Gruppenführer Odilo Globočnik, whom was greatly liked by collaborationist Serbs. Whether this change affected the SS's relationship to the Waffen-SS is unknown, but doubtful. Shortly thereafter, Hermann Neubacher, Hitler's special political representative for the Balkans, paid a visit to the Autriche in Trieste to discuss German fears about what would happen to the SS, and Chetnik forces in Istria came into contact with British and American troops, who were expected to move in the direction from Italy. Ljotić reassured Neubacher of the Estaka's loyalty. Meanwhile, Tito's 4th Partisan Army was advancing north along the coastal road from Novi Vindolovski, Croatia, to retake Istria, Trieste, and all of central and western Slovenia. German Army Group E immediately issued orders to the 97th Army Corps to build a perimeter around the port city of Rijeka to try and block the 4th Army's westward advance. In early April, the 237th Infantry Division was rushed to the area, and within a few days, defensive positions were establishing a 21-kilometer arc to the east and north of the city. The 4th Army began its attack on Rijeka around the 20th of April with the partisan 13th, 19th, and 43rd Divisions. Although the outnumbered German 237th Infantry Division offered stiff resistance and held its position, General Kubla ordered the 188th Reserve Mountain Division to launch an immediate attack on partisan concentrations in the vicinity of Grobnik Airfield, 16 kilometers northeast of Rijeka. To support this attack, the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th SDK regiments were moved up from the Postojna area. However, the regiments of the Serbian Volunteer Corps arrived too late and never made contact with the 188th Mountain Division. The attack on the airfield was unsuccessful, and by the 23rd of April, it was clear to General Kubla that his corps was threatened with total encirclement. Kubler's appreciation of the situation was entirely correct, as on the 22nd of April, General Staff of Tito's 4th Army ordered a flanking movement to bypass the city. While the 92nd Corps continued to be pressed by three divisions, the partisan 20th Division was brought up from Ogulin along with one additional brigade, three tank battalions and two artillery battalions. This force moved to the north around the German defensive perimeter and advanced on Trieste through Ilirska Bistrica with the intention of linking up with the partisan 9th Corps, which was pushing south on Trieste. To support this attack, the 2nd, 3rd and 4th SDK regiments were moved up from the Postojna area. As the battle for Rijeka moved towards its inevitable conclusion, SDK regiments 2, 3 and 4 were sent to Ljubljana and transferred to the authority of SS Obergruppenführer Erwin Rosner, high SS police leader for Carinthia, who had been appointed commander-in-chief of Army Group E's rear area. Rosner's task was to open up and keep open the road and rail routes in northern Slovenia to facilitate the Army Group's withdrawal from Croatia north into Austria. SDK regiments 1 and 5 remained assigned to Globočnik, who had meanwhile transferred his headquarters from Trieste to Udine across the Sonzo River in Italy. The SDK was therefore split into two groups, one in central Slovenia under Rosna and moving towards the Austrian border, while the other was in the extreme western part of Slovenia under Globočnik moving toward Italy. At about this time, on the 22nd of April, Neubacher paid his final visit to Ljotić. A total collapse of German forces in the Balkans and in Italy was recognized as being only a matter of weeks, if not days, away. Neubacher wanted to know Ljotić's plans for withdrawing and surrendering the SDK, which was some time ago renamed the Serbian SS Corps, or the Zabiše SS Corps. The next day, during the hours of darkness, Ljotić accidentally drove his car into a hole that had been blown in a bridge by Allied firebombers. His neck was broken and he died shortly thereafter. On the 29th of April, as Tito's forces were closing on the Trieste area, General Damjanovic issued orders to the 1st and 5th regiments to cross into Italy, where on the 5th of May, in the town of Palmanova, 50 kilometers northwest of Trieste, between 2,400 and 2,800 Serbian SS men surrendered to the British. These men, belonging to the other three regiments, experienced a less agreeable fate. They moved north from the Ljubljana area into Austria and surrendered to the British at Unterbergen and Klagenfurt on the Drava River on the 12th of May 1945. 20 days later, these 2,418 men were turned over to Tito's partisans. Some were executed almost immediately in the Kočevski Rog massacre, while the others were carted off along with the 10,000 Slovenian Domobranci to the infamous Šentvid camp near Ljubljana. Subsequently, these two were executed. These events became known as the Great British Betrayal, which was mostly the fault of Harold Alexander's deputy who authorized the transfer of various German-aligned Serbs back to the Yugoslavs. Alexander himself, who fought in the Baltische Landwehr, successfully saved some of these men to the wishes of Churchill as well.
We had to invent the lie that we were sending them to Italy. And we told them that all through those 10 days. And it was a matter of great agony, shame to us, to betray these people in this way and to lie to them. But there was no alternative if we were to carry out the order that we were given to send them back to Tito.
The group that surrendered in Italy was eventually transported to a camp at Munster, Germany, where they were released in July 1947. These men made their way to various countries around the world, including the United States. General Mushitsky was arrested by the Allied authorities, returned to Yugoslavia, and executed in 1946 as a result of sentences passed at the same war crimes trial that pronounced the death sentence on Draža Mihailović and a number of others. Nedić's story, as on the 6th of October, he fled from Belgrade to Kitzbühel, Austria, then annexed to Germany, where he took refuge with the occupying British. On the 1st of January 1946, the British forces handed him over to the partisans. He was incarcerated in Belgrade on charges of treason. On the 4th of February 1946, it is believed that Nedić either jumped out of the window of the Belgrade hospital where he was being detained, or that he was pushed out to his death. According to official records, he committed suicide by jumping through the window. According to the Register of Victims, killed after the 12th of September 1944, Nedić was, quote, liquidated. I would also like to comment on the story of Serbian Waffen-SS commando squad, the Ringelnata group. First Serbian Schutzstaffel commando Branko Gašparević, nicknamed Gara, a teacher, later captain of the Yugoslav army, who was a distinguished Serbian patriot. The fact that he was promoted into the rank of Hauptsturmführer by the Germans tells how much they had respect for the captain. A group of 45 Serbian commandos was sent to a training camp in Neustrelitz, Mecklenburg-Vorpommern, in November 1944. The special training of the elite Serbian SS formation was conducted by no one other than Otto Skorzeny, the famed German commando and the, quote, most dangerous man of Europe, which mentioned the training of this group in his works. They were accompanied by the chief of the 4th Anti-Communist Regiment of the Special Police in Belgrade, Božidar Bečarević, with his own elite squadron named Viper. The main goal of these elite units was the liberation of Serbian lands from communism, according to their statements, as well as neutralizing top priority targets, leaders of the communist guerrilla. The plan was also to ambush partisan units and to create an underground system that would gather all nationalist citizens in a united front of national resistance. The final goal was the creation of a nationalist army that would rise and crush the newly formed communist regime. While trying to create a coordinated front with Serbs in Bosnia, presence was detected by communists. They got in tracks of Gara, and he and his closest companions were captured, trialed, and executed. Shortly after, the Ringelnata group was surrounded and fell in the fight against partisans that outnumbered them by hundreds. This marked the end of broad anti-communist resistance in Yugoslavia, and it should mark the end of my video.